I'm Graham and I hope everyone's having a great day. Welcome to part 4 in this new video tutorial series where I'm looking at basic photography with Panasonic Lumix bridge cameras. Now in today's video I want to look at shooting close-ups and macro with these particular cameras. In particular I'm going to be shooting with the FZ300 330 today, just as a way of mixing up the cameras that's used in this tutorial series. So how do we define the difference between a close-up picture and one which is macro? Well, the real difference is the fact that macro is defined as anything with a 1:1 or greater magnification. So that means if you've got a 6mm insect on a plant, if that insect becomes a 6mm size image, then you have achieved a 1:1 magnification and that becomes a macro image. Now, to achieve a macro image with these cameras, it does mean that you're going to have to use some supplementary lenses, as the main lens itself wouldn't support a 1:1 macro, but it does support some close-up work, as you'll see as we progress through this tutorial. Now, these cameras will actually focus down to about 2 to 3 centimeters if you use them in the wide-angle mode. That means that your lens is almost touching your subject. And that does give you some perspective distortion because you're using such a wide angle lens and your subject is so close to the lens itself. It's better if you can move your camera a little bit further back and you don't get this perspective distortion at wide angle, but then you do have to slightly zoom in to maintain that same image magnification. Now in this video I'm going to show you how to find out what are the magnification ratios of your lens at any particular focal length. Now, the easiest way to discover what the field of view or your angle of view is for your particular camera is to actually take a small rule. I've got one here which is 20 centimeters long, and then you can just photographic or just observe the field of view in the viewfinder or on the LCD screen. So what you can do is set your camera into the manual focus mode, then use the control to set the focus point to the closest, so that's the flower icon on the back of the screen. Set your lens to say the widest angle, so 20mm in the case of the FZ8082 and 25mm with the case of the FZ330 or the FZ1000. And then just rock your camera up and down until you find the focus point on the LCD screen. And then position your camera so you've got the left-hand edge on the left-hand side of the viewfinder. And then read off on the right-hand side what the actual millimetres or centimetres is that you've got in the terms of field of view for that particular focal length. You can then repeat that for the whole of the focal range. Now, to save you some time, I've actually created charts for each of these cameras. The manufacturing tolerances between these lenses should be very minimal, so what applies to my camera should really apply with your camera. So you can see we've got the FZ80, the FZ300 and the FZ1000 there. And you can see the field of view at each particular focal lens, so you can get an idea of just how wide the subject will be for you to achieve the closest working distance with the camera. So with those charts, you're going to get an idea of the field of view that you're going to get with any particular focal length. Now, if you're photographing something like flowers outside, obviously you're talking about 4 or 5 centimetres wide. If you're talking about insects and you're talking 6 or 7 millimetres long, then if you want to have a larger size images on your sensor, then you're going to have to use supplementary lenses. Now, these come in many shapes and forms. The simplest is what's called a singlet lens, and these are usually available in sets of 4. A +1 diopter, +2, +4, and normally a +10, and they just screw onto the front element of your lens. Now, they're an ideal way to get you into close-up photography. They give you an idea of what sort of strength of lens you'll need for your particular type of photography. Now, these lenses do suffer from a few problems, but they're an ideal way to get you into close-up photography. And if you find you like it, then you can progress to what I would really recommend for close-up photography, and that is the use of an achromat lens. But these simple lenses, +1 diopter, 2, 4, and 10, will give you an idea of what sort of strength you need to work with your normal images. The next step up would be a achromat lens, and they are available on eBay in the second-hand market, as they tend to be becoming quite rare these days. You can get a 250 or a 500 achromat lens. Nikon and Canon produce them, and in fact Panasonic used to do one, but I'm not sure how widely available that is at the moment. But they're quite expensive for what they are. Now, the next preferred solution is to use one of the Raynox close-up lens adapters. Now, these come in two styles. One is the 150, which has a 4.8 times diopter, and the other is the 250, which is an 8 times diopter. So the number 8 is quite a strong lens, and it's one that I wouldn't really recommend until you get the hang of using these and knowing just how much shallow depth of field you are limited to with these particular close-up lenses, where the 150 allows you to get a reasonable working distance from your subject. So if you're photographing butterflies or other insects which are a little bit skittish and fly off at the you're getting close to them, the 150 is probably the ideal solution for you. Now, these come with a spring clip which allows you to fit them onto the front element of the lens, so they just clip onto the camera like so. They will adjust for a variety of lenses, from say 49mm all the way up to 62mm. But my preferred solution is actually to use a step down ring, and this one is from 52 to 49, and then that just screws onto the front of the camera. Now, that has two advantages. It's optically centered, and it's not likely to get dislodged and fall off if you catch it on a branch or anything like that. So that is my preferred solution. Now, the disadvantage of these lenses is the fact that they are 43mm diameter lenses. So you're with the FZ 300, you're going from 52 to 43 with a step down ring. You're going from 55 to 43 on the FZ 80, and you're going from 62 down to 43 on the FZ 1000 or 2000. So you do have to zoom in a little bit to overcome that problem. Now, with the Panasonic camera, there's a facility in the setup menu called conversion. And if you set it to conversion, it will actually move the camera out to x4 zoom, which is enough to overcome that. Now, I don't normally bother with that. If you're zooming into about 150mm or 200mm, which is the normal sort of working range for me, then that's overcome the vignetting anyway, so I don't have to worry about that switching on of conversion to allow the zoom to happen. So ideally, 150 to 200mm should see you in the right area for your photography. Again, the sweet spot of the camera lens, f4, is a good ideal starting point for these particular lenses. If you want to go to f5, 6 or f8, you can try it and just see just how much of the image quality you lose with that feature we call diffraction. But sometimes you might want to see a little bit more depth of field and suffer the loss of quality of the image rather than not have enough of your image in sharpness. So it really is a suck it and see type of operation for your particular type of photography. Now, when you're working at these close distances, again, subject motion blur is a problem for you, because not only is the image probably moving if it's an insect or if the plant's moving in the wind, but also any element of camera shake is magnified by the image magnification. So it's important to use a fairly fast shutter speed. You want to be using at least a 3/20th or a 1/500th of a second. So that does limit you to fairly bright sunlight or just slightly overcast conditions to enable you to use that f4 at ISO 100. Now, because of this need for a high level of illumination to capture your images without subject motion blur or wind movement, sometimes I would use electronic flash. You can use the pop-up flash and put a small diffuser on there, and that would help. But it's better if you can use some modelling with your light, and I tend to use a wireless triggered handheld flash, or you can use a wired extension cord if you want to, but I was showing you that in another video, as that would extend today's video well into the 30-minute section, and I don't want to keep you for that long. I am going to go outside now and try and shoot some images with this FZ300 with just the focal length available of the camera to show you what field of view and what size of images you'll get. Then I'm going to install this Renox 250 lens, which is the highest magnification, a plus 8 diopter, and show you the size of images you can pull in with this particular lens, and noticeably the shallow depth of field. So if you're expecting to get a bee in focus from its tip of its antenna to its hind legs, you will be disappointed with this lens, because you won't be able to achieve that. There's not enough depth of field in this. Okay, enough of this serious stuff. Let's go outside, let's shoot some pictures and explain how we capture these images. So I've now come outside, and we're going to have to try and put what we've learned in theory into practice. We've got here some Himalayan mountain balsam. They are now a very invasive weed here in the UK. They're a very, very nice pictorial plant, but they are becoming extremely invasive. And when the seed pods explode, they can explode for 2 or 3 meters. So these things seed like mad, and you can probably see in the background, they're just about everywhere. And they're almost up to the border in Scotland now, so these things are moving north very quickly. So These things range from a very, very pale pink to a very dark crimson, depending on where they're growing in shade and that sort of thing. So we've got a range of topics here where we can actually shoot a very light subject, and a bit further over there, some quite dark ones. So it gives us an opportunity to try some of our techniques for capturing detail in the petals of these things, which are very bright or very dark. Now, I brought out the FZ300-330 as a way of just changing the camera that we're using in this series. So, first of all, I'm just going to try some standard pictures with the camera. Again, aperture priority, round about f4, ISO 100 with this camera, shooting at the base ISO and the sweet spot of these lenses, which tends to be about f4. The shutter speed should be quite high because we've got a little bit of sunlight. There are some clouds coming over, so we'll go into shade in a moment, but that shouldn't prevent us from taking some decent pictures. In fact, in sunlight, you're at a disadvantage when you're shooting flowers because of the high contrast that you get. In fact, I'll show you a technique that I brought along which reduces the amount of contrast, and we can get some even better pictures than we can in very bright sunlight. So I'm going to set up and just take a couple of pictures of these two blooms here at various focal lengths and various camera distances, just to show you the effect that this has on your final image. So, just as the sun goes behind a cloud, and it looks as though it's going to be in for a few seconds, so the video will probably go dark, so I'm shooting in manual mode. I'm going to switch over to the program auto mode, so the camera will be able to track the changes in brightness as it goes from bright to dark. So I'll just switch over to program auto mode. Well, I've now switched the camera over to program auto mode, so it should track the brightness a little bit better than leaving it set in manual. So we will see some changes in image quality as the sun comes out and goes back in again, but it shouldn't affect the overall enjoyment of the tutorial. So the sun's just beginning to come out again now, so we'll use that as an opportunity to try and capture this bloom here. It's going to be against some foliage in the background, so I'm going to be able to isolate this foliage from the background by using the focal length. So first of all, I'm going to take a picture at about this distance, 2 feet away. So aperture priority mode, f4. Now what I'm going to do is, because it is a bright petal, I'm going to add some negative exposure compensation so that I can actually try and retain some highlights. Now, if you're shooting in RAW plus JPEG and you're used to handling RAW files, you can probably get a little bit more detail out of those petals by processing that RAW file. But if you're shooting in a standard JPEG mode, which I normally do all the time with the smaller sensor cameras, then just to underexpose slightly gives you that opportunity of capturing the highlights. So I'm going to go underexposing by about 2/3 of a stop. So by using the exposure value compensation, dialing in 2/3, again, single area autofocus with the focus point set on the front of those petals. And again, waiting for the wind to stop. And that's captured that one. Now, just a bit further around are some darker petals. So I'm going to try and capture those. And we can see the difference in the way that the camera is responding to the intensities of colour in each of the petals. So I'm just going to move a little bit further around. I'll work at about the same distance. And again, because the sun is at 180 degrees to the camera axis, it's falling right into the viewfinder. So a tip I can give you there is just to hold your hand in front of your face there, and that gives a little bit more shade and it allows you to see inside the viewfinder a little bit better. So let's just capture that one once the wind stops. And that looks fine. Now it's a little darker petal, so I'm going to go from -2 to -1. So let's capture that. And nicely timed, there's a bee just going into the plant. So that is with the lens set at 50mm and as close as I can get. Now, if I really wanted to isolate this subject, remember we use a longer focal length. So I'll use the facility of the FZ300 where we can actually go out to 600mm. So I'm going to go right out to 600mm. And again, I'll need to stand back because I need to be about a metre away in the AF macro mode to enable us to get a focus point. So just checking that I'm in AF macro, and that is AF macro, so I should be able to focus at this distance, and there it is. So I'm just going to isolate those top two petals against that black background from the foliage, and that looks quite nice. Right, just looking for other images to capture. There is a dandelion here which are nice to capture, but before I do that, I'm going to show you this technique for reducing the contrast on these white petals when we've got a sunlight. So I'm just going to stop the video while I get this attachment out of the bag, and then we'll carry on. So what I have here is it's a pop-up flash diffuser. Well, it's a pop-up flash reflector and diffuser. So these things you can buy on Amazon or eBay. They're relatively inexpensive, ideally for flash, but you can use them for this sort of photography by allowing it to use as a diffuser. But you're diffusing the sunlight. So you're going to put this in between the sun and your plant, and that gives you a nice soft light, and that reduces the shadows in there and gives you a nice soft overall lighting source for your picture. So we've seen the images without the diffuser in place. I'll get the camera again and we'll take another picture of this white petal and see the difference. So I'll take the shot first while the sun is out full. So that is a shot with the sun, and now I'll bring up the diffuser and we'll capture this. We've got auto white balance in place, so the camera will compensate for the fact that we've gone from sunlight to shade, which obviously changes the color temperature, but the AWB or auto white balance should compensate for that. In a later tutorial I was showing you how to set up for a manual white balance, which is ideal in some situations where you want to get very accurate color rendition. So now we're going to try and move location, see if I can find those ragworts over in the back of the field, which gives us a smaller plant to work with, and that gives them the opportunity then to use some supplementary close-up lenses. Well, I've now found this ragwort. It's not in the very best of conditions. There are a couple of bees and hoverflies trying to get around it, and there's a snail at the top of the plant, so we'll go try and take a couple of pictures of that. Now, I've brought with me the Raynox 250. It's a lens that I don't often use. I prefer to use the 150 because the 250 gives you a very high magnification and very shallow depth of field, so it's not ideal for this sort of shot where I want a little bit more depth of field to capture things like insects or this snail. But we'll have a go. It means working towards the wider end of the telephoto scale rather than the 200 to 400 that I normally work with the 150. With the 250, I'm normally working sort of 50 to 100 millimeters, which is just on the verge of vignette with the lens mounted on the FZ300 because of the way that this thing has a 43 millimeter thread, which is obviously smaller than the 52 millimeter thread of the camera. So you have to zoom in past that vignette point. So let me take a picture first of all of one of the blooms. So yeah, you've got to zoom into 60 millimeters to get rid of the vignette. Again at f4.5, got burst mode on, let's just turn that off, but into single mode. My exposures are 250th of a second, so that should be adequate. There is a little bit of movement, so it's a case of just waiting for that still moment and then capturing the image. Now, if you're shooting insects, it's better to put your camera into high speed burst mode and let the camera shoot a three frames, and hopefully one of those frames the insect will be in the right position or you'll have the right focus. The sun should be coming out in a couple of seconds, so that gives me a higher shutter speed to work with. Well, the Canon M50 is a great camera, but it doesn't have heat through batteries fairly quickly. That battery was fully charged before we came out, and I've got just probably a half an hour at the most shooting with that battery. So battery life for the M50 is incredibly poor. I would prefer to run with an external battery pack, but I got enough gear to bring with me today rather than carrying the external battery pack as well. So the sun's just come out, so I'm just going to try and capture this snail, which is in the top of the flower. He's not in a very photographic position, but it demonstrates the power of this lens. In fact, it's quite a hot spot, so I'm going to reduce my exposure by using exposure compensation to minus 2/3. Again, you can hear the beep as I'm not in the focus zone. There's no other insect life on here. Now, this petal here is facing the sun, so I'm just going to do a little gentle rearrangement of the two blooms together, just to separate them a little bit. Some women would say that's cheating, but it's better for composition. So let's You might have seen the technique I was doing there was I let the autofocus grab the autofocus point, then I rocked backwards and forwards until I was happy with the actual focus. So I'll just demonstrate that again. So I move in, the autofocus has got that, and then I'm just going to move, keeping my finger on the button so it's locked, focus and exposure. And I said that the sun goes in, so the exposure changes. So I'll do that again. Autofocus lock, and then just rock backwards and forwards until you find the focus point. And again, the wind has started, so that's destroyed that opportunity. Now, I did notice another snail, and he was on a plant somewhere nearby. Well, there we are. That's some ideas for shooting close-up and macro work. I'll expand that a little bit more when we look at using electronic flash to light our subjects. It will be a multifaceted video, that, with flash for portraiture and flash for close-up photography. So the techniques are the same. It's just a case of adapting them for your particular type of photographic operation. For example, on close-up, you might want to consider a ring flash rather than just a handheld flash. I don't recommend the LED flash units. There's just not enough power in those. They're ideal as a video light, but in terms of a flashlight for stopping action, no, forget them. They're not powerful enough. Well, that's it for this video. I hope you found the content useful. And of course, if you are a new viewer, please do click that subscribe button and of course the bell notification icon to get warned of when I upload the next video in this series. Also, check out my photographic blog. I'll put a link to that in the video description below. On the homepage is the application form to join my newsletter group. And that goes out to something like 3,000 people every month now. It's more than a newsletter, it's a technical publication in its own right. So please do check that out. And if you haven't joined that group, just fill out that application form, which gives me the authority to send you the email. Incidentally, the next video will be one of these supplementaries in between the main topics, and this will give you some more background information on how the camera works, and we'll be talking about exposure and how that's determined and why we should get it right. Okay, until my next video, thanks very much for watching. Please do take care, and I hope to see you all in the next one.